Hey guys, what's going on? Master Cloud here, and I am back to bring you guys another cast of The Lord of the Rings, The Rise of the Witch King, The Battle for Middle-earth 2. I think I got that a little out of order, but we'll let it slide for now. Today's matchup is going to be a 1v1 on the Fords of Isen 2. This is going to be played on the 2.02 patch, so we will be continuing to take a look at this patch, and both for myself and for you guys, I hope this helps you learn a little bit more about it. Now, we do have, let me go ahead and introduce the players here. Spawning in the lower right-hand side as men is going to be MAU's Frosty. And he is, of course, spawning down here as men and actually going for an incredibly economic, opening 4 farms off the start. So pretty much straight-up econ for Frosty here. And his opponent is going to be across the way here, MAU's Sania. I believe, actually I have no idea if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but I'm going to be calling him Sania for this match, so that's how it's got to be. But anyways, he's going to be spawning as Isengard. Now, this would appear to be a 1K game, as of course there aren't any heroes popping out yet or anything like that, so it should be a 1K game here, and actually you can probably check that by going to the money. Yeah, absolutely a 1K game. So, looks like he's actually going for an early warg pack here. A very interesting opening for Isengard, not something you would see at all in the 2.01 patch. So this is actually a little surprising to me, but we'll actually have to see how this works out. Wargs in the original patch were actually, or in 2.01 patch, were really not that good. It looks like Frosty here, he's gone for the 4 farms, and that's about it for now for farms, and now he's gone straight into barracks, and then archer range is going to be producing a group of Gondor soldiers, as well as a group of archers to go ahead and provide them support from behind. Is this work pack out yet? I think, yes, here it is. So it is going to be moving across the map here. Let's see if he can actually get across the map here and do some damage to Frosty's economy before the troops are out, but too little too late as the troops are already out. So I think Frosty here getting away with a little bit of a sneaky economic opening. Actually, those wargs do tons of damage, and that base is going to be have to cancel immediately. So apparently these wargs, this warg pack in the 2.02 patch, extremely effective against buildings, and it looks like actually they have perhaps a rally call or something thrown down. He has the creeping. So it looks like the rally call is actually going to be going down on the archers there, and they are going to begin to engage these wargs. Looks like they do die pretty fast here and are able to take off, you know, pick off maybe 1 or 2 archers, but that actually goes up to level 2 here, and this warg going to be slowly chasing them down, but the fortress will go ahead and finish that off. Meanwhile, another pack of wargs in the front trying to go for a couple of these buildings, but the pikemen are out now, and a second group of archers. I mean, there's just no way that this is going to be effective. And Frosty is going to be able to easily pick this off. A third warg pack now making its way is going to find the base to the north. That's going to be a nice little pickoff for him there, as these wargs should be able to deal enough damage. Yeah, I was confused because it looks like just all the wargs have a sort of a yellow glow underneath them. Usually you'll see that like under these archers here when they have the rally call, but I don't believe the wargs actually have a rally call. I believe they're just spawning to look that way. We'll actually manage to get that farm, but we'll lose the group at the same time. Now, a group of Gondor soldiers going to be moving up around the backhand side. Maybe took out a furnace, hard to say exactly, but this warg pack is going to be able to chase them down, especially with the Kreeban overhead, or the Kreebane, I don't know. The crows, we're just going to call them the crows because I can pronounce crows and know that I'm saying it correctly. Looks like they're going to now be moving down to the south as a second unit of Gondor soldiers here. Going to be moving up from the bottom side. Frosty doing a nice job in this game, I think, of putting on some pressures of his own, but also holding off the pressure of that warg pack. He's actually been able to rebuild some of these mines, so actually his economy is thriving right now, and he has several units, 2 units of pikemen, 2 units of Gondor archers here, moving across the river. This unit of Gondor soldiers going to fall, but not before dealing significant damage to this warg pack, and only being at level 1, this warg pack has no way to heal. So they're just going to have to be, they're going to have to jog in place for a while, as that's, you know, really good for their stamina and everything. But they will have to sort of lick their wounds in order to instead of actually being able to be healed there. Now, a group of Wildmen out here. Of course, Wildmen not very good at unit-to-unit combat, much better in terms of unit-to-building combat. And actually, he has another group of Wildmen up here already taking down one of these buildings. But it looks for now Gondor, a.k.a. Frosty here, going to be ignoring sort of the pillaging troops running around the field and just going to be mainly focusing on the infrastructure here. And I think he's got Sania in a very tough spot here. Now, this building is actually just in range of the fortress here. So it looks like he's actually going to fall back with some of his troops. Doesn't want to lose these just yet. Instead, is just going to pick off the units as they spawn from that building. With the archers just kind of sitting here, they're basically just waiting. Are they on? Yeah, they're on aggressive stance. So anything that pops out of this building, they will immediately start shooting at. And instead, he's going to swing around down to the lower hand side and go for one of these mines that's a little bit more exposed on the south side. Now, of course, these guys are both from the same clan, so they probably have played against each other several times. And it looks like Frosty here has Sania figured out a little bit better than Sania has Frosty figured out. And now he's going to move forward. He's not worried too much about the damage anymore because he has enough pikemen here to very quickly take out this warp pit. Actually, this warp pit, very sturdy. Actually, Sharku now comes out as a hero. Normally would not suggest Sharku as a hero, but he is going to be trying to chase down some of these Gondor's archers. They have split up here, going in different directions in an attempt to save one of them. Sharku appears to have a very large amount of health, at least against these archers. I mean, they don't do a ton of damage, but even so. Now, he is going to lose that warp pit. The Gondor pikemen now falling back are going to be able to engage this wildman quite easily, though. And, gosh, the infrastructure here of Frosty continues to expand. Does he have a building up here? Does not at the moment. Guys, I didn't take too long to introduce the map, but I believe most of you have probably seen this map before. And Sharku now going to be fleeing from these troops, as they don't really have. He doesn't really have enough here to actually go ahead and storm the fortress quite yet. But he's going to stay in the area. Sharku actually going to find a builder. A couple hits from Sharku is going to go ahead and take the builder out. And Frosty not able to respond quickly enough to that builder being attacked, so he will go ahead and lose it. Sharku now actually heading down here, might spot these archers, and that's going to be a really great pick up for him. There's no pikemen in sight, and I think these archers are basically screwed. I mean, they're level 2 archers, so that's kind of unfortunate that he's going to lose them this way. But there's just not much he can do against this hero unit. The second builder now moving actually a little close. You don't want to lose this one as well, because he's going to have to build an additional builder then, which of course is going to cost a ton. It looks like a group of wargs, a pack of wargs there, able to maybe take out another farm, but then get killed themselves. That farm, of course, is already rebuilt. Now, we do have the more advanced archers out, and actually, Sharku not able to finish them off. I think, there's an attack here on the back of his base, so he's decided to pull his hero rather than finishing off the archers to bring them back. But I don't think he's going to actually make it in time. I think he's going to lose this. Might lose a couple of units here as well. Where is Sharku? There he is. There's a ton of pikemen in here, though, so he wants to be careful. He's most likely focusing down the pikemen with his archers here. And Sharku is going to charge right through the archers there. And, yeah, there's only a couple of pikemen left at this point. And Sharku's going to be able to easily clean up the remainder of this. A second group of archers now out as well. Isengard archers have such long range, and there's actually hobbits being spawned. Whose hobbits are these? Of course, they're not Isengard, so they are going to be for Gondor. But I think those hobbits should go ahead and turn around and focus Sharku. I'm not sure why he's running with these hobbits or why he summoned them if he's just going to run. Hobbits actually tend to be very good against hero units. But it looks like he's just trying to get out of range of the archers, and now he's going to turn around. Not quite sure I agree with that move there, but... Anyways, Sharku does leave the scene of the battle irregardless. And he is going to be, I guess, picking off a few hobbits down here by himself. Now Sharku up to level 5. We haven't seen a hero yet for Frosty, which is kind of surprising. Men has several good heroes. Aragorn and Boromir, who is, of course, a prince of... the son of the steward of Gondor. But hasn't decided to actually go for those heroes right now. He's just going to continue his units, basically pure per unit spam, I guess. I mean, it's not really a spam, but it's purely unit-based strategy. without heroes, is what I mean to say, or sort of extra units such as, you know, catapults, or what else does Men have? Horsemen, stuff like that. He's just a very ground-based, slow, methodical style of units. And looks like he is going to find a furnace down here. He's going to get a nice round, throws down the rally call. And he's definitely going to be able to get this furnace. It looks like Sharku, though, able to lead a group down here as well. Now, Lurt's out as well, so we have two heroes out for Sania and zero out, as far as I know, for Men. He does get the furnace, but I think he's going to lose two groups of units here, and I'm not really sure that's worth it. I mean, he's got plenty of other units over here, but actually, these Wildmen are going to be sneaking around the backside and take out a furnace. They are stealing those resources. That building was not canceled, which it probably should have been. And finally, we have a hero out for Gondor here, but it's going to be Aermer, who isn't... I mean, he's a decent hero, but I'm surprised he went with Aermer instead of a little bit stronger of a hero such as Boromir or Aragorn. But Aermer a little bit cheaper on the same side as well. And Sharku here sneaking around the top side. I'm not really sure why he's hiding back here. I guess just to heal. But Lurt's now up to level 2. Going to be working down that cave troll and will not get the final shot, so he does not get that experience. A little bit of a mistake there, possibly. But we'll continue to work down that cave. He will go ahead and use Lurt to work down the cave troll lair there to grab that experience. Meanwhile, a huge attack on the upper side. That's why he's recalling those archers. But Sharku is here with plenty of units to deal with this. Actually, the ring being dropped here. Aimer kills Gollum, but then flees the scene as he doesn't want to take the ring for himself. And Sharku says, hey, if you don't want it, I don't want it either. And he is just going to continue to run around here. Aimer trying to chase him down. The Gondor troops here actually winning this battle, but Sharku continuing to bowl over several of the archers at a time. And now the archers from the bottom that were in Lurtz's army are now moving forward to the north and have arrived as reinforcements. They are going to begin to pick off a lot of these archers and pikemen. More pikemen now spawning for Isengard. Does have a set of wildmen units down here he could use for the battle as well if he wanted to. Somehow Gondor able to still be alive through all of this, the Gondor units that is. But Sharku is going to make fast work of that as he continues to chase down the archers here. Actually doesn't kit them, but now Aemir looks like has decided, you know what, I don't like the look of this battle as there are now way too many units out for Isengard and actually doesn't get this mine. That's a little bit of salt in the wound there as basically he threw away a ton of units for very little accomplished. I mean, he killed off a couple of Isengard units, but Isengard is doing just fine because he has the two heroes out. I mean, he has enough furnaces to actually be almost constantly pumping out units. Doesn't have any Wildmen on the way. Actually, he does now. He just started up another group of Wildmen, just started another group of Urk Crossbowmen. So plenty of units coming out. One unit around the backside here, able to grab a furnace. That's going to be a nice pickup, but he's going to lose the unit at the same time. And it's always sort of a toss-up, one unit for one furnace. You know, it's worth it, but at the same time, it's always nice to keep those units alive and build up a little bit bigger of an army. Now, the ring actually was captured here by Isengard, so we'll see if that actually comes into play or not as Sauron. If Sauron comes to the field, that should be pretty epic indeed. No more heroes out for Men quite yet. Does actually have the marketplace. Yes, I was going to say marketplace, but I wasn't sure. It's been so long since I've seen one. And, of course, the marketplace does allow you increased... I believe it's increased funding through the mines. I think that's why they have sort of a glowy look here to them. But Sharku and Lurtz now leading a charge here. He's going to summon, throw down the Wildman summon in the back with the archers. And Lurtz throwing down his... these archers getting poked in the back here. And they will fall as well. But Lurtz actually taking a lot of damage, but he's going to throw down his Carnage ability and begin to pick off a lot of those archers. They just can't deal the damage fast enough. And suddenly Isengard, now more troops from the north as well, taking down one of the mines here, one of the farms of Men. suddenly Frosty is looking to be in a very troublesome position, as he's lost almost his entire army. I don't even know if Ammer is still alive. I mean, does he have any units around the backside harassing? No, this base is completely uncontested right now. And Lurt's actually going to fall back. Did take enough damage there that he is nervous about losing him. Sharku, though, has now healed, and he will be returning to the battle. Ammer is still alive, does have that spear throw available to him if he wants to use it. Actually, should chase down Lurt's and throw that spear. That'd be pretty epic. But for now, just going to fall back from the battle. More archers coming out, though. Should be able to pick off these wildmen from afar, as they're not quite up to him yet. But these archers just... I mean, there's two groups, so they're dealing sufficient damage, but there's nothing in front. There's the spear throw. Does hit Lurtz in the face, but at the same time, Lurtz was healed enough that it didn't kill him, and then Lurtz gets off the cripple shot. Oh, no. Ammer will go down to Sharku here, or to Lurtz, or to the pikeman, one or the other, but he will fall. And that was an epic fail. That's like where you throw the spear, and instead of hitting him in the face, it hit him in the, I don't know, left arm. And instead of killing him, just weakened him severely. But these horsemen, the horsemen summon, able to chase him down. So he does at least get Lurtz out of that, but loses Ammer. Will have to spend his horse summon here on basically on defense. You like to use your horsemen to sort of bowl over a large unit of enemies, sort of on offense, or use the horsemen to run around and harass. But it's going to be using it here mostly for defense. It's going to be running into a pikeman unit. That's not necessarily the best idea. Does actually grab a wildman pack though there as well, though. Has lost a decent amount of these horses, but is going to try and go ahead and use that harassment strategy. Now, if possible, actually does have the inn down here as well. Is going to be building additional wildmen from the south. And Sharku actually finding a mine down here as well. I want to say Frosty has hold this, but he's still in a very tough position. In terms of, not necessarily economically, because he does have the scattered mines around, does have the marketplace, so he is making a decent amount of money. But in terms of units, I want to say that he is going to be slightly behind here. I mean, Sharku has a man-eater ability now at level 7. Kill target enemy, which restores Sharku's health and temporarily grants 50% damage. Man-eater, wow. That seems kind of good, actually. I wonder if that works on hero units. But for now, they do actually end up taking out that farm. And the archers here are going to be able to clear this area, at least temporarily. As Isengard here goes ahead and rebuilds, begins to rebuild his army. I would expect to see Lurtz coming back out soon. I wonder actually if we'll see Saruman in this game. That would be interesting as well, Saruman or Sauron. Yes, actually, we can check what his money is situation is. It's only at 530, so he's basically spending his points almost instantly here. He's spending his money almost instantly. He's spending his points pretty liberally, too, as he's got two level 5s, and I'm guessing this is a level 10, so two level 10s. Whereas Frosty here, going to be spending his points... going straight up a tree, 5, 10, and then 15, now probably saving up for its 25 power, which of course for men is going to be, I believe, Earthquake, or, you know, I'm not sure of the other one actually, and the PowerPoint trees for these guys might actually be different. Now that we are playing on, of course, the 2.02 patch, we'll actually have to open up the game sometime and check those powers out. But for now, these units... going to be, I guess, rallying around Ammer as he's back on in the field. Actually, Ammer's going to take the horsemen north. The remainder of the troops going to go towards the center. And a small group of Isengard units here caught out in the center of the map. I mean, they're going to actually grab some archer shots or some archers here just as they're upgraded to fire arrows as well. But with the reinforcements from behind, they're not going to be able to kill off these archers completely. Actually, might get this group. That would be really great if he could finish them off. Only one remaining for this group. And will not get it. So both of those units actually will survive there, and the crows will fall as well, as those archers quickly shoot those crows down. And Ammer has complete control over the top side of the map here. I mean, he could pick off this right now, but there is pikemen, two Urk berserkers, as well as some wildmen coming here, and we'll see if Ammer and his horsemen here can actually work through that, building a mine here right in front of it. The horsemen actually. get a pretty nice hit there, taking out a majority of the Wildmen. Did lose a couple, but throws down the rally call. Is going to begin to work down these buildings. He's trying to basically avoid the battle and go for the buildings, but I think with so many units here, he's going to have to fall back. This might only make six per round. And Sharku's going to make quick work of that, or these pikemen will. One or the other, and he's going to cancel that building and basically have to fall back. I mean, with the pikemen here, he just cannot engage with the horsemen. So instead, he's going to recall his army that he sent to the middle to deal with these pikemen to the north. And this game continues to wage on as it's kind of confusing exactly who's in the lead right now. In the beginning, I would have given it to Frosty, but in the middle, it looked like Sania was winning. And now it looks actually pretty even. I mean, Sania has the advantage of the heroes, but Amor at level 4 is going to be charging through the backside here. I mean, he has the other units out on the field to back it up, and not just, you know, level 1 units. I mean, he has the advanced pikemen, the Gondor Tower Guards. He's got the, Aethelion Rangers with the fire upgrade. So, I mean, these aren't just, like, basic troops running around. These are upgraded strong troops that he has out on the field. At the same time, Isengard has moved into that Urk Berserker production, which of course deal damage incredibly quickly despite only being a single unit. And they can take out these Gondor guards in basically one swing of their giant blades. I mean, it looks like they will get taken out here, but that does buy time, of course, for the other units to move forward as well. And actually, he's going to fall back here, as he doesn't want to engage these fire archers directly. The horsemen still running around as well. Are these summoned units? They are not. So he does actually, yeah, he does have the actual building out here. And they're actually going to find Sharku on the bottom here. I think he's going to be able to run away from this. Amir going to start to work him down, though. And yeah, he needs to pull him back here. And we'll go ahead and escape there just barely. Now Lurt's leading his own unit down on the left-hand side. Looks like this building was destroyed most likely by some of those horsemen. Or another stray Gondor unit is possible. But with that destroyed, his Wildman production is slightly hampered here. But, I mean, all really not that much, to be completely honest. As he has five groups of Wildmen here. Does he just have one clan steading? Yeah, but he has two barracks in the back. Wouldn't mind seeing some upgrades, as this might be a good time to throw down that upgrade ability, unless, of course, he is saving up for Sauron, as he has almost $6,000 in the bank right now, or 6,000 gold or barrels or whatever. Why does this look like a barrel for the money sign? That's really strange. But basically, is saving up for Sauron, it would look like, and men actually saving up for something as well, possibly Aragorn, as he does have almost 2k of resources. Sharker here actually has activated the Man-Eater ability, so that actually is on cooldown right now. Would have liked to see him use that, but did end up missing that, I guess. As these units now moving forward, I mean, the army here for Gondor is much better, though. The pikemen in the front, the archers in the back, now summoning the hobbits, or summoning the hobbits. Summoning hobbits as well. And, yeah, Isengard is going to have to fall back. I mean, the problem here, of course, is that he's saving his money trying to go for Sauron. Of course, when you do that, you risk the chance of not having the units out on the field when you need them. And basically, he's realized that and basically canceled his dreams of going for Sauron at this moment, built some tower fortifications, and is now ramping up production at pretty much all of his production facilities as this group charges forward. I mean, he knows he's beat here, but he's trying to hold on as long as possible until these extra units get out. And I think he might have just enough here, at least to deal enough damage to this army, where it's not going to be able to finish him off right now, especially with the tower extensions on there. Sharku coming in from the back. I mean, these heroes are making all the difference right now for Isengard, at least in my opinion, as they are just wrecking the front and the rear line. Actually, might get Sharko here. Those fire archers deal a lot of damage to him, but no, I think he's going to be able to actually run away fast enough. There is some horsemen down on the bottom side here, dealing a considerable amount of damage. Frodo falls there as Sam and Mary, or I'm not sure if that was Mary or Pippin, but actually has gone, instead of saving up for Saruman, has gone for Saruman, which is going to be very interesting to see as well. Is going to get the push there and can't even kill the tower guards with that, but does severely weaken them. The arrow drop comes down. Actually only takes out a single archer as Sania there responding very, very quickly to that archer drop. And did he actually have to spend... actually has gone for Army of the Dead here. So he now has his 25 power points, has Army of the Dead available to him, and basically these horsemen still alive in the back here, able to take out an additional furnace. Amber still alive, up to level 6. And Sharku, actually, you do not want to engage the Sharku. You're way too weak. One throw of that spear from Aramir, and I think you're done for, but I guess he doesn't realize it. Instead, he's going to be falling back, as he basically doesn't want these units to get surrounded. Even so, taking out Sharku, I think, is going to be the right choice there. But was he producing back at home during this time? Let's go ahead and switch to all view here, as he does have a couple of Rangers, one unit of Pikemen, a couple of Horsemen on the lower end side, and we do hear Army of the Dead spawning here as he sees his opportunity and throws down the Army of the Dead to begin clearing up all of these units. Sharku going to be running right through the Army of the Dead. That is not what you want to do, Sharku. And Saruman actually able to escape. Well, I may have spoken too soon as Saruman is getting chased down by a full Army of the Dead here. And there's no way he can escape from that. Their time is almost up, but I think they will actually end up getting Saruman. They do, and they will continue to chase down Lurts here. But the timer has been either slightly shortened or their killing power has been slightly reduced, as they will eventually time out their Lurts going ahead and using his Carnage ability. But still, I would definitely say not a waste for the Army of the Dead. A really great move there, as he did take out a very significant amount of units for Isengard. And now if only he can back this push up, finally, we see Aragorn out on the field. And this is the moment we've all been waiting for. As Sania does go, as Frosty goes ahead and now begins to push forward with a very scary looking army. Could actually use a couple of additional units here. Looks like they're on the way very shortly. Yeah, should have two more units. And I think that's going to be enough to really start scaring Isengard here. I mean, he's basically resorted into building a wall hub. He might have done that to save the builder. I'm not sure quite yet, or if he actually wants to build a wall right now to hold out his opponent. But the horsemen occupying the army of Isengard as the main force moves in from the east side. The horsemen basically just charging down all of the furnaces right now. I mean, Isengard has the money, but can he actually produce the units fast enough here, as these archers and Aragorn now have reached basically the front of the base here and are going to start to immediately break down a lot of these furnaces. I mean, he's basically just spamming furnaces right now because he makes so much money off of each one of them. The horsemen are on the backside, going to get taken out. Where are the additional units? Here they come, finally. I haven't seen Airman in a while. Actually takes out a builder there, so great pickup there for Frosty. And basically, I guess he just wants to work down all of these furnaces right now is his current goal. Aragorn only level 1 right now. Would really love to get him to level 2 so he can begin using that Blade Master ability. But that furnace will fall as well. And I think Isengard is a little bit scared to engage right now. He doesn't have quite the number of troops. Actually going to be bringing them from the north side. Decides to go ahead and engage now that he has out the Berserkers. Going to be summoning the Wildmen as well on top of it. And I think Sharku just used... No, he did not. But gets the complete surround here. And the archers fall almost instantly. The pikemen without the archer support fall as well. And I think Aragorn... Yeah. Not Aragorn's finest hour, as he quickly falls to that massive amount of troops. So I guess the answer was yes. And here's the other troops that he really could have used in that battle. Now they're going to be quickly picked off as well. Hammer showing up to the battle way too late. He's like, oh, guys, what's going on here, guys? I just took a nap. And actually throws a spear there. Grabs a couple of units, but yeah, he's going to have to fall back. I mean, I saw a unit of Coda, didn't I? Where did that unit of Coda go? Did they just charge in there and die? I really hope not. Here they are. So we do have one unit of Coda out. Of course, Coda stands for the Knights of Dalamroth, which are very, very powerful knights in terms of damage output. These guys just deal ridiculous damage. It's just terrible damage. And basically, unless you have, if you have three units of them and you can storm an enemy fortress and kill it within basically seconds, the only response to this is to build, you know, expansions all around your fortress so that the knights cannot get a complete surround on it to actually deal the damage fast enough. Now, we only see one unit of Kota out right now, and that fortress is currently going to be able to stand up to that just fine. But the Kota could do a significant amount of damage to any enemy heroes, archers, things like that. They will also just tear through. So here stands Gondor's army. A couple units of archers, a couple units of pikemen, a couple units of horsemen. Very mixed army. Does have armor in there as well for the hero. I actually like Isengard's army a little bit better this case. I think because he has the Orc Berserkers in here. I mean, those mixed in the army like this is just going to be incredibly terrifying. Saruman back on the field, up to level 2, does have that Fireball ability available to him. And Gondor's army moving through the bottom side here. How are we doing for power points? Oh no, the Summon Dragon ability is up right now for Isengard, and he can drop that dragon right here if he wants to. Aragorn is out, uses the rally call. The Kreven, or the crows, come out. Does a summon, but there's the dragon. There's the dragon, and all of a sudden, you know, Frosty is like, oh! You know, and we'll try to run away here. Actually, that dragon just epic failed with that fire breath, and it's going to save the majority of his troops. I mean, these are going to be picked off to the north. And we'll actually end up killing one unit of archers there. This unit will escape, but gonna lose the majority of his army here. Despite oh, and the dragon's already gone. The dragon was terrible. That dragon was terrible. Saruman throwing all those Gondor soldiers back there, and looks like he will continue to fight here. I mean, I guess he doesn't really have much of a choice, as these units will quickly fall, though. He basically lost his entire army there. Oh, I'm sorry, the dragon didn't leave. He can use his reposition ability. I totally forgot the dragon had that. And we'll instead go for some of the infrastructure here. He does manage to take out the upgraded barracks. We are seeing an additional archery range being added on. But this dragon's time is almost up. Actually needs to go for right here if he can. We'll see if how much damage he can deal. A holy ton of damage. Burns the marketplace down in one hit. And can the dragon actually kill off this archery range before he times out? The answer is maybe, and the answer is no, as he does get a decent amount of damage on it, but cannot finish it off. And suddenly men looking to be in a little bit of trouble. Frosty, I mean, he has a couple of units to the north here, does still have his Kota. I mean, honestly, Sanya needs to push here. He needs to push, but he refuses to. He just keeps falling back. And I guess he's scared to push and lose his army. But I mean, one of these guys actually has to put on some pressure, as this game has been just basically even for the past, I don't know, 15, 20 minutes, it feels like. As neither one of these guys, I mean, they're just kind of sort of trading armies. We need to see some unique play. We need to see some, I don't know, strong attacks, well-positioned troops, something to go ahead and... you know, not saying that they're incorrectly positioning the troops. I'm saying that they could do it better. Basically, that they need to show some outstanding play to go ahead and convincingly win a battle. And after that battle, they need to push with the remaining army and begin to destroy the infrastructure in terms of production for their opponents. I mean, destroying mines at this point, it's nice, but I mean, there's so many out on the field that it's almost irrelevant to try and go for farms or for Isengard for furnaces at this point. Now we will see if he is trying to save up Sauron again. It looks like the answer to that is going to be no. Power menus for Frosty is going to be going saving up for Earthquake, it looks like, as that is the next... his next 25, his next and last 25 ability. Isengard moving to the south from the center and from the north. Okay, now we have a three-pronged attack from Isengard. This could be good. We'll actually see how far he pushes in with each of these. Looks like the army is focused in the north right now for Gondor. And actually, Gondor does not have a lot. He's been rebuilding his infrastructure here, but doesn't actually have that many units out on the field. And looks like Saruman, moving from the north here, decides to spend his money on Cloudbreak instead. Will deal a significant amount of damage, uses the Cloudbreak and the arrow drop to kill off a ton of those archers. Sauron gets in close, though, is going to use his Shockwave ability, has Fireball still available if he'd like to use it, throws down the Wildman Summon. The units from the center are still stunned by Cloudbreak, the same for the units in the bottom, but Lurtz looks like they are coming off Cloudbreak now, and Lurtz is going to be working down this farm as it builds. Might be able to actually kill off the Builder when he spawns. I want to take a look to the north, though, as Amr and the Coda beginning to work down Saruman. Should be able to take him out very quickly, and yeah, he can't get the magic spell off. The Coda deals way too much damage. There is a couple units here yet, but with the Coda... With a second unit of Coda, these units are going to fall very quickly. The pikemen do come in, though. Of course, Coda not very effective against pikemen, so we'll have to fall back here, it looks like. And basically, all his units here, that three-prong attack kind of turned into almost a three-prong failure. As, he lost his units to the north. His units to the middle actually moved up to assist. I mean, he still has this army here, so if he can do something with it, it's not going to be a total failure. Alert's now joining the battle from the south, but the three-pronged attack has basically turned into just a center attack now, which is fine, but Lurtz getting a little over-eager here, going to be running out in front. We do have the horseman summon, though, and all of a sudden this Isengard attack, which we've been waiting for, is not looking nearly as effective. We do have the Tainted Land bonus going down there to try and beef up Isengard's units as much as possible. Who is going to win this battle, though? That is the question. Aragorn, now up to level 4. Of course, does grant that leadership bonus. Throws down Blademaster, and I think with Aragorn in here, and the Knights of Dalamroth, yeah, Lurtz is going to fall right here. Aragorn might get this final swing. He does indeed. Grabs a bunch of experience off of that. And actually, did Isengard win this battle? Even with Lurtz dead, it looks like there's a significant amount of Isengard troops still alive in the back here. Aragorn just can't take on this many units. Sharku now showing up as well. But he's right in front of the enemy base, so of course his units are spawning almost instantly, whereas the reinforcements for Isengard spawn way back here. And I think with the reinforcements now, yes, finally Isengard troops going to be slowly killed off here. I mean, a group of wildmen showing up, sure, Mike actually getting the Builder would be a really nice pickup here, but can't do enough damage to units. Does get the structure, nice pickup. But more units now coming out for Gondor, for Frosty. And this game has just been back and forth. Isengard, I mean, he's pushed in, he's got the advantage right now, but can he hold it? Actually, Wormtongue now coming out, probably to deal with Aragorn. And oh my gosh, is Isengard still alive here in the center? Oh, I think this is the Wildman group that just came up. Aragorn's going to make short work of them. The Horsemen going to hunt down the remaining archers. And yeah, this is definitely going to be a hold. Now a return push coming by Gondor. Needs to throw everything he has. Needs to grab these troops. I don't know why he's standing back here with them. Needs to grab these troops and push forward. I mean, he just won. Oh gosh. He just won a decisive battle. Well, not a decisive battle. He just won a battle, we'll say. And now has the opportunity to push. Isengard actually falls back here. Maybe trying to lure him into a trap a little bit. As he knows, really, Isengard's troops right here are going to be better suited for this battle. But throws down the Lightning Strike instead from the tower. Did go ahead and upgrade that tower to Lightning Strike, the Lightning Strike ability. And does indeed throw that down to deal a significant amount of damage to some of the troops here. It's not going to kill everything, but it was enough to deal some damage. We do have the Rally Call going down now, and Isengard basically faking an attack here in the center, and instead sending his troops around the bottom side, and it looks like the top side. as they will pick off a group of archers there. That's a really great pickup for Sharku. And the top right now is owned by Isengard, as he does have almost that entire top side under its control. Decides to pull his entire force that he sent to the bottom back. Redecides to send three units forward instead, one of those being Wormtongue. And, of course, I see now. He's pulling back to deal with these horsemen, but... Whoa, one swing there took out like three or four horsemen, and another swing will take out the remaining two. Amor coming in way too late. Once again, Amor, the dirt-to-dirt of the game for showing up late to every battle. Looks like men will win in the center. A couple of Wildman axe throwers here, but will get taken out as well. Those fire archers deal so much damage. Isengard now showing up with his own troop here. Does have Sharku in the back with a couple of Orc Riders. Will go ahead and take out a farm that was a level 2 or level 3 farm. So that's a really nice pickup. Actually could pick up a couple of additional farms here if he's lucky. Does have the units on the bottom side. More archers spawning though. Actually going back down to just the Gondor archers. Not sure why he's pumping those guys out instead of just sticking to the Thilian. But Aragorn frozen here in the center. Going to be facing down an Urk Berserker and Lurch from afar. Sticking him like a pig here as does throw down the heal. And now throws down the Army of the Dead. It is off cooldown. And suddenly Lurch is like... Lurch realizes he's got to get out of here. And is Aragorn going to survive? Is he actually going to win this battle though? Does he have the reinforcements to back it up? His reinforcements are trying to deal with Sharku in the backside here. Needs to bring these units forward right now though. Sharku can only deal so much damage by himself. I mean, he has enough troops on the field right now. If he brings them all forward, where'd that Army of the Dead go? Is it already up? It is chasing Lurtz way to the north side here. As if he had his units here, if he had his units together here and pushing forward with the Army of the Dead to basically cover him, almost all of these buildings would be destroyed right now. Instead, he's going to chase these units way too far north and basically surrender his claim to the center of the map. I mean, Aragorn's still here, but does he have backup? That's the question. Finally, bringing in the troops from the south here. Does own the south side of the map now. To the north, going to be losing, or going to be capturing a couple of mines as well. And suddenly, Frosty looking to be in a good position. The problem is, Isengard has a ton of troops yet on the field here. And Saruman's going to get a great hit off here on these troops if he's paying attention. And he is not, as he's just going to be able to hit a couple of them with the horse, or hit a couple of them with his staff. Needs to use some of his abilities here. Orc showing up from the left-hand side. Should go for the archers here. Saruman still in the battle. He's taking some decent amount of damage, but Loudbreak goes down as well. That should temporarily stun these Orc Riders. Saruman finally gets off one of his spells, though. Should clean that up pretty fast. Aragorn showing up to the battle a little late. The army from the north side continuing to push forward. These archers need to attack this. They're just standing here. As they do pick off a single builder there. Or a single log carrier. But the problem is now to the south side. Isengard has won this battle. Arrow drop goes down. Catches a decent amount of units there. But Aragorn's death there going to be enough to fuel the spirits of Isengard here. This army is going to win. He's lost the battle to the north, though. And these troops continue to push forward. They need to begin taking these structures out. You actually want to leave the lumberjacks and just go for the structures. And we see Earthquake going down. Going to throw it down right there on a ton of the production. And oh my gosh. Okay, I thought he wasn't going to get that. So takes out a ton of the production there, so no Wildmen for a long time here for Isengard. And I think that might be the nail in the coffin, or at least the coffin lid on Isengard here. I mean, Isengard, he has a ton of troops. The problem is he's just lost a ton of his production. He's got the Watcher. That's a nice pickoff there of a lot of those archers. But... He's running. I think he's going to be low on income now because he doesn't have anything on the bottom side of the map. He doesn't have anything on the top side of the map. I mean, it's all been cleared. How many furnaces does he have here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but they're all so close together. I wonder how much money they're actually making him. Does actually have 10,000 though. Oh my goodness, he's been saving up this entire time. Had 10,000 there for a second, just spent a ton of it though. I don't know why he didn't purchase Sauron. That I think would have been the right choice, as he's almost actually up to level 25 in terms of powers. And I'm not actually sure if that was the coffin lid on Isengard, as now he's suddenly looking good. I mean, he doesn't have the income, but he does have... I mean, he almost does, because Isengard makes so much money from each furnace because of all of its, powers from the powers menu. And actually, does he have 10,000 again? No, he's only stuck at 8,000 right now. But is beginning to rebuild those buildings. And this match continues to go on. This is an incredibly long battle here between these two teammates. As the battle continues to rage, I cannot believe how long this game has been going on. As these players are probably basically exhausted at their keyboards here from constantly having to manage these troops. But the battle continues to rage with no short end in sight. The dragon summon comes down to deal with the troops here. Does get the fire breath off there. That's going to be the remaining troops for Gondor. Needs to reposition this dragon immediately right here. Work down all three or four of these buildings. Possibly even get the force range if possible. Tom Bombadil shows up to the field. Isengard needs to push right now, though. With the dragon on the field, he needs to push. He's going to get a great reposition, though. Actually deals a ton of damage to all of those troops. The dragon needs to work down the buildings, though, right away. How much time does he have? Half time remaining. I do not know what he's chasing right now. He's chasing these troops. Terrible mistake. Oh, fire strike from the dragon. And that might be the proverbial nail in the coffin for Frosty. Turning this around is going to be Isengard, as he uses both of his 25 powers at once. Now working down the stables, and he doesn't have any troops out on the field. I mean, he has Aragorn, and he has like a couple units of Gondor soldiers. He's going to be losing his horse range, or his stables here, though. The dragon still has some time. Might be able to actually get another building. He has plenty of health, so that's not going to be an issue. But he has three production structures right now. Basically, no troops on the field. Is going to grab a mine before his time runs out. And can he actually grab one more building? The answer is no. But I don't think it's going to matter. Isengard needs to push, and they need to push right now. He needs to grab all of his troops and charge the heck forward. What is he waiting for? Now is the time to strike. If he kills this army, I mean, what is he going to have to deal with? A couple of Gondor soldiers, you know, occasionally popping out? I mean, it's just not going to be enough. But instead, he charges forward with two heroes alone. Going to lose one of them immediately. The summon does go down here for Frosty. I mean, what is Sharku doing? It's not clear to me why he is running through this army. And now I think Gondor has had enough time to go ahead and start rebuilding some of these troops. I mean, he still has the fire archers available to him. And Isengard just not able to capitalize here. I mean, he's gone for the upgrades on some of his pikemen here. Sauron is back out on the field, level 6. Needs to get to that level 10 coerce if he can. Sharku here going to fall. And, I mean, he has this now, but isn't going to be enough. That is the question. Needs a watcher right here, but doesn't have it off cooldown. There goes a lightning strike from, I guess that was Sauron? Or was that from his tower? No, it was from Sauron. The Thunderbolt, excuse me. The archers in the back. Now, there's so many archers out. Saruman does spot them, though, and needs to work these archers down right away. What's he waiting for? They're now escaping. And he's going to lose a majority of his troops here before Sauron can get off this hit. Needs to use his abilities here, but instead just pulls him back. No. Saruman running through the entire Gondor army without using a single ability. Finally gets one off, but too little too late as the fire archers pick him off. Isengard continuing to push forward, but Aragorn is here. There's archers here. More archers spawning. More Gondor soldiers spawning. An additional barracks has been thrown down. He needs to use these guys to pick off... he needs to use these war riders to pick off the archers right now. That's what's destroying his army. He's good in the upfront combat, but he's losing in the range combat. Finally, these units are able to take out that farm, and they need to charge through, not stay and fight, as these archers are now going to pick off the war riders as well. What does he have to back this up? He's building units. They're just not rallied together. He needs to rally these units together, charge forward here, and finish this game so my voice can have a rest. As now the building's continuing to go back up, a siege work's now coming up for men. Very interesting choice this late in the game, but we will see if that does come into play. Who owns the top of the map right now? It's going to go back to Isengard. So back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and back and forth it has been. As these two titans continue to clash, I mean, there's a small skirmish in the middle. That's going to easily go to Gondor. Isengard going to be winning on the bottom side. One group of rangers not going to be able to hold off this amount of troops. More heroes on the field. We need to see Sauron to end this game. Does he have the money? The answer is no. Why sit at 7,000 resources if you're not going for Sauron is the question. Just use something. Actually, did he just... Yeah, just use Devastation to grab a bunch of additional resources. Aragorn pushing from the center, though. Finally, back up to 10,000. Is he going to go for Sauron? That is the question. Has the 10K, needs to go for Sauron to finish this game, decides to spend some of it elsewhere, though. And I want to keep an eye on that income as he does there. Once again, go over 10,000. That does give him access to build Sauron if he so chooses. The question is, why isn't he chooses? Of course, I said that wrong on purpose. Why isn't he choosing to build Sauron? And the answer is, I have no idea why not. It's just spent 3,000 probably to rebuild Saruman. And I guess he's just going to stick with his basic heroes here. Wormtongue out on the field does have backstab available to him now that he is level 5. So Aragorn beware as he is actually moving up to the battle right now. Almost level 10 himself though, just barely before level 9 here. Wormtongue needs to get in there and use that assassinate ability, backstab rather. And does see him there, will get it off as Aragorn is poisoned. But, oh gosh, gets hit by the fire and will burn to death there from those archers. And Aragorn falling back, sees he is poisoned, so is going to fall back probably to that fountain to heal if there is one up. Not that I see, but it looks like he has completely rebuilt his base here. So men doing completely fine. Excuse me, guys, one second. Whoa. As I take a drink of water here, as this battle continues to rage on. We are now moving on to almost an hour into the game. As this game just will not end, this file is going to be huge. It's going to take me like literally a day to upload this entire replay to YouTube, just as it sits now, and the end isn't even here yet. I mean, this is just incredible how long these players have been playing, how back and forth this game has been. At this point, Isengard continues to push forward, but I just don't see an end in sight. I mean, will one of these guys ever actually win, or is it just going to be a draw forever? That is the question. Aragorn now having to face down Lurtz. I think Lurtz is going to have this one in the bag though with that carnage ability activated. Aragorn out of heals, cannot use Blade Master here. And Lurtz trying to get in a good position, actually falls back. I don't know why that had to happen. Tom Bombadil gets a blast from behind. Saruman now on the field. Why don't you use your powers, Saruman? Use your powers, you are a wizard. use wizardry. Finally, we get the fireball from Saruman. I think that's the first fireball he's used all game. Could use the wizard blast as well. Rather, should use it as well. Decides to use the lightning, the thunderbolt. That worked out pretty effectively, actually. And Isengard looking to have a good position here in the front. Aragorn weak. A couple of troops here. Does have plenty of infrastructure, though, to go ahead and be able to produce produce units very quickly here. Tom Bombadil actually falls. So Tom Bombadil will go ahead and die there to several Urk Berserkers. The remaining archer is going to die as well. That income, of course, coming off of, I believe, Lurtz's level 8 ability, Pillage. And the force continues to push forward here. Does have a group from the bottom as well. Isengard looking to be in a decent position. Does he have the backup? I mean, he has troops just sitting back here. He needs to pull these troops forward. That has been the problem, I think, for these players. The biggest problem that I've seen is that they don't reinforce fast enough. They have a huge army sitting back at home, but it just sits back at home until this army dies, and then they pull it all together and bring the next army up. Why not reinforce right now? I mean, these troops can be moved up right now, put together with this army. Now, to be fair, I mean, this game has been going on for, you know, 56 minutes right now. And these players are probably getting a little tired, getting a little, you know, flustered that they haven't been able to finish the game. But, I mean, they need to, one of them needs to win. And whichever one sort of gets his stuff together fastest is going to be that winner. Now, we do have Army of the Dead coming down here, four men. Going to use that as a defensive tactic to go ahead and clear out this army. And in retrospect, what I just said about combining his army all together might have actually been a great thing that he didn't do, seeing as how Army of the Dead would completely tear it all apart. Saruman going to die. Lurt and Wormtongue able to escape, though. This Army of the Dead should time out before they get any additional kills. But actually, this army is moving forward a little fast now. Might want to fall back until the Army of the Dead is destroyed. I don't know why Lurks and Wormtongue aren't staying with this army, though. And yeah, he sees the Army of the Dead, turns tail, and runs. Will they actually go ahead and catch one more of these units? Yes, they will. That's a nice pickup. But as soon as this army... Okay, so now the Army of the Dead is gone. Basically, what I said before now applies. He now needs to gather his troops, reinforce quickly, push forward here. And I think we are going to go ahead and speed up the game here a little bit as until we get to the next battle here. As I cannot believe how long this game has been going on for, and no clear winner yet. Is Isengard close to having his summons here? The answer is pretty close, as that might be sufficient. But at the same time, Man almost has Earthquake back. Aragorn now up to level 10, summons his Army of the Dead. His personal Army of the Dead, and Lurtz is going to fall. Lurtz does not run, so he will die to that. And now Frosty looking to be in a decent position, although this huge troop of Isengard blocking any reinforcements kind of puts a damper on his strategy right now. There's so many troops. I mean, Isengard has mined out the entire forest on this map. There's basically no trees left. Of course, the trees do regrow, so there's always trees left, but... It's just funny how long these mines have been going for. And Isengard does have this troop here in the inside of Men's base. Although, I mean, look at what he's picking off. You know, a single farm here, you know, a unit there. The summon does go down four men here. That battle will take place here pretty quickly as Isengard's troop... Isengard is going to lose pretty much all of his troops. You know, a skirmish around the map here and there, but we have yet to see a decisive victory, a decisive win, and a decisive push, decisive win in terms of a battle. and a decisive push following that battle to sort of end the game. Aragorn running into a bit of trouble as Isengard moves forward with a huge force. Does he have the dragons to back this up? The answer is almost. Any second now he's going to have both the summon dragon and the dragon strike abilities available to him. He does have a huge force pushing forward here. Does men have anything to stop this? They have the earthquake available to them. So this army could die instantly, and the answer, and there that goes down. This entire army destroyed. Does save a little bit here, but actually catches his own building there in that earthquake. A little bit of a mistake. A couple of warg riders survive. More pikemen coming out, though. Should make short work of them. And the dragons are now available, or one of them at least is. But he doesn't have the army to back this up. Look, he wasn't producing an army back at home. Still isn't. So we'll once again wait for his army to be built up, or for him to summon those dragons. We'll actually see what he wants to do, as he does actually summon, throw down the dragon summon in the absolute, really not a really good place. I should have done it over here. He's going to use the dragon strike over here though. And how many of these buildings is he going to get? Grabs 3, 4, really great dragon strike. And this dragon, you do not need to go for the farms right now. This is not the right decision. He needs to take out the infrastructure. And with that, oh, men surrenders. Frosty, he lost too much there. Decides to go ahead and tap out. And unbelievably, Isengard's MAU's Sania wins that match. So finally we have an ending. And it was going to be the double dragon strike, or the dragon strike and the dragon drop, that goes ahead and wins that game for Sania there. The Isengard final powers, too powerful. Men never able to get the good push there. And so it ends. Thanks everybody for tuning in. Really appreciate the support, and hope you guys enjoyed this game as much as I did. But an incredibly long one, an hour long game there. So on the 2.02 patch, that is. So guys, hope you enjoyed. Stay tuned to my channel. And Master Cloud, signing out.